Before we get started with today's message, which I've entitled Sinking Ships, just to remind everyone here, if you have a little one, that we have our children's church taking place today. Just in case you came in late and you got a little one there in the pew, maybe you're watching us online, you're wondering whether to stay there at home or stop by, Living Water's very first children's church is taking place right now downstairs. An awesome worship service designed just for the kids to bring them closer to Jesus Christ. So I encourage you, in fact, I promise you, their experience downstairs is going to be far greater than anything I have to offer you here in this sanctuary. How do I know that? Because you guys are stuck with me. And they have my wife, so they got the better part of us. So I encourage you, please, downstairs, the children's church, you are going to be blessed. But for those of you who want to remain here in the sanctuary, I invite you to pray with me and pray for me as we open up God's word once more. Let us pray. Father, you know I have not the words to speak. You know I have not the thoughts. You know I am just here needing a word from you. So Lord God, speak and let your words burn in our heart. Let it reach the part of us that only you can touch to bring healing and to bring salvation. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. I've entitled today's message, Sinking Ships. Sinking Ships. And if you have your Bible with me, or if you've got your phone, or whatever you may be reading God's Word in today, I invite you to turn to Acts chapter 27, where we find ourselves. Now, if you have been following us this last quarter, you know we've been studying the book of Acts, our series, The Acts of the Apostles. And actually, our series ends next Sabbath. It's already been 3 months, believe it or not. And if you're new to this series, we have been studying the book of Acts, looking at the experience and the power of the early Christian church and how we can reflect that early church here, today, at Living Water, which in and of ourselves is an early church. Amen? And in Acts chapter 27, we find Paul. For those of you, again, who haven't followed us, Paul, the Apostle Paul, who was originally known as Saul, the persecutor, he who chased down Christians from city to city, from country to country, looking to shackle them, bind them, imprison them, even execute them, until Jesus personally reached out and literally knocked him off his seat and revealed himself to be the Son of God, transforming Paul's life into one of persecution into an apostle, into the greatest witness that the gospel had ever seen. And now Paul, who had gone on multiple missionary journeys all over the Roman Empire, the then known world, having faced all kinds of persecutions himself, from stonings to beatings to whippings to imprisonments to being left for dead, finally comes back to his home and his home church in Jerusalem. Not to receive quite the reception that he was desiring. For his fellow countrymen, the Jews, sought to kill him, to take his life. And just in a short time after his arrival at Jerusalem, he finds himself accused of such treachery to be executed. But being a Roman citizen, now he gets his day in court. And in fact, he claims his right for a trial before Caesar. who was none other than the bloodthirsty Emperor Nero. And so we find ourselves now in Acts chapter 27. Paul is awaiting his trial. The Roman centurion, the Roman soldier, is taking Paul from Judea and now taking him to Rome to stand trial before Nero. And Paul is about to embark on his voyage by sea. And now before we jump into the verses, I want to set the context of that. You see, how many of you have been on a cruise? Anybody been on a cruise before? Couple folks here have. Anybody been on any kind of boat out there? Anybody been on a boat? Like, I've never been on a cruise before. I wish I'd been on a cruise. When I think of a voyage by sea, now I'm thinking of, you know, what is it? Norwegian Cruise Lines and Carnival, right? You know, and I see these all day, all you can eat buffets, right? And they got pools on both ends of it. They got basketball courts up there. I mean, you know, they are living it up, right? Now, I've never been on a cruise, but maybe one day one of you guys can take me. Don't worry, I will accept your invitation. Don't laugh too hard. But I've been on smaller boats, you know, smaller vessels. And, you know, you get to soak in some sun upstairs, you know, and then you go under deck and you got a little living space and things like that, you know. And even on the smallest of vessels today, you still have a guidance system, right? You got a GPS, you got a little shortwave radio, right, to contact for help. You got all these things to care for you on your journey. But back then, any voyage by sea was treacherous. You know, they had no GPS, no navigational equipment, none of that stuff. The best of sailors still used the sun and the stars as their navigational tool. Well, that sounds great because, you know, the sun's always going to be up there and the star's going to be up there. But what do you do on a cloudy day? What do you do when the storms come? They could easily get lost at sea. Now, to make matters worse, once late fall and winter set in, the storms came to the Judean and Roman region. And it wasn't exactly like they had the propulsion systems of our boats today. They didn't have the safety equipment. They didn't have, anybody here get seasick? Anybody here get seasick? No, y'all get, yeah. I get seasick even just like reading in the car. Like, I can't handle any kind of motion. Like, you know, I can't handle that stuff, right? But imagine what it had been like traveling by sea back then. How easily it would be to get sick. And how long any trip would take. Now, imagine all the difficulties and challenges of sea travel, even in the best of conditions. But here is Paul, shackled, chained, a prisoner. Ellen White in the Acts of the Apostles even mentions that he was sick and in poor health at that time, which makes sense because imagine all the suffering he had gone through in his life. So now he is taking this voyage, this difficult voyage, even under the best circumstances, but as a weak and sick prisoner. And that's where we find ourselves, in Acts chapter 27. And I'm going to be starting in verse 13. You know, as a side note, as I studied this chapter this week, I found out that even non-Christian historians say that Luke's account of a sea voyage in this chapter is one of the strongest historical recitations of what sea travel was like back then. Luke was not just a doctor. He was quite the historian. And you know, if he could take such painstaking details to describe what the voyage by sea was like, we can trust his details on the life of Jesus Christ in the early church. So Acts chapter 27 and verse 13, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation. It says this: when a light wind began blowing from the south, the sailors thought they could make it. So they pulled up anchor and sailed close to the shore of Crete. But the weather changed abruptly, and a wind of typhoon strength called a northeaster burst across the island and blew us out to sea. The sailors couldn't turn the ship into the wind, and so they gave up and let it run before the gale. Now picture the ship. It's trying to take cover by the shore of the island. And a massive typhoon, gale force wind, comes sweeping across the island, hits the sail of the ship. And remember, that ship is trying to go is trying to go horizontal with the island, but it blows them out to sea. So to stop it from blowing out to sea, they try to face the wind so the sails would face the wind, but instead they have to turn and let the wind carry them off into the sea, at which point they will be lost. Can't see the sun, can't see the stars, no navigation, and they can't control their direction. And they are blown off to sea. Verse 16, we sailed along the sheltered side of a small island named Cauda, where with great difficulty we hoisted aboard the lifeboat being towed behind us. And then the sailors bound ropes around the hull of the ship to strengthen it, for they were afraid of being driven across to the sandbars of Syrtis off the African coast. And so they lowered the sea anchor to slow the ship and were driven before the wind. They were so terrified that the ship was going to tear apart, they threw ropes over one side, caught it on the other side to keep that ship from falling apart, to keep those timbers tightly in place, lest this storm and the waves and the wind tear them apart. Verse 18, it doesn't get any better. The next day, as gale force winds continued to batter the ship, the crew began throwing cargo overboard. And the following day, they even took some of the ship's gear and threw it overboard. The terrible storm raged for many days, blotting out the sun and the stars, until at last all hope was gone. You know, later in the chapter it says this storm lasted for 14 days. 14 days, no control of your ship, not knowing where you are, with no hope in sight. Chained. Sick, feeble, this was Paul on his voyage to Rome. I think a lot of us can relate to Paul's journey on that ship. You know, there have been times, I'm sure, in your life and in mine, where the sun came out and the soft winds blew, and everything looks like smooth sailing ahead. You got a job, comfy and cozy, making good money, supporting the family, your health is well, you exercise, you take care of your diet, you smile, keep that flu away. Everything seems to be going in your favor. And you're taking a comfortable cruise on that beautiful sea, when all of a sudden, the storm winds blow. Out of nowhere, it hits you, and it hits you so hard, it knocks you off your feet. Anybody here know what I'm talking about? That one day you went into your office just like every other day that you have gone year after year after year. You walked into that office, but you got called into that boss's office that day. And when they said, sorry, Neil, we love you, but we gotta let you go. Sucker punch. You can't breathe. Unexpected storms in your life. You went to the hospital for a routine checkup. I mean, it's simply just for precaution's sake. I'm sure it's nothing. No need to worry. You'll be done in about an hour and you can head back home. Only it wasn't just nothing. But you were diagnosed with the final stages of cancer. And you've been given days or weeks to live. We have all faced some kind of storm in our life. You came home from work with your health and your job only to find your husband was not home anymore. In fact, he was never coming back. You found your son, your daughter, passed out in their bedroom, overdosing on drugs. Folks, it happens to the best of us. In the church, out of the church, life happens and storms hit unexpectedly. You know, the thing is, though, God has placed a vessel in this life that will not fail. And it is His church. His church as a reflection of His Son, Jesus Christ. You know, the message is entitled Sinking Ships. Folks, this ship that Paul was on was sinking. And our life, many times, is found taken in water and going under. And we've been studying the early church. We've been studying how the church today reflects that church back then. And folks, even the church will take on water. The Christian church back then and today and tomorrow still will face persecutions. And it will get worse. And the storm is going to hit so hard, you think this ship is going to tear apart. It will start sinking. But like Paul, even chained up, beaten down, tired and weak, you cannot give up hope. Because a sinking ship is not a sunk ship. And God's church will never go under. But you got to stay on board. Let's continue. Verse 21. Now no one had eaten for a long time. And finally, Paul called the crew together and said, "Men, you should have listened to me in the first place and not left Crete. You would have avoided all this damage and loss." And I want to pause right there because prior to verse 13, there was a time where they were safely harbored in a city called Fair Haven. And they took a vote, essentially. Who thinks we should stay here because the winter is coming? The passage to Rome is getting thus much more dangerous. But this is not an ideal place to stay, not to shelter for the winter. And the captain and the owner of the ship and the other sailor said, "Look, if we can just get a little bit farther to the port city of Phoenix, it is far more hospitable to stay for the winter months. It'll be a lot more comfortable." And Paul was overruled. And they found themselves in this situation. Oh man, how many times in your life, and I'm going to tell you, I'm a witness right now, how many times has God told me to sit still or to move on when I said that is illogical, Lord? Trust me, God. Because this city is inconvenient. This position is inconvenient. That call to ministry is inconvenient. That job, that's not for me. Believe me, that one is. I'm going to make more money and I'm going to give you more. and I'll have less hours so I can do more in ministry. I got this. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody been called to be in one place? You know you've been called, but all logic, reason, all your friends, all your family, all the people you trust, no, you got to go over here. And it's just a little bit farther. How many times we find ourselves in the midst of the storm because of our own doing. Amen. And folks, sadly, if your storms in your life were like some of mine, we take on casualties that scar us for the rest of our life. Man, some of those storms, I still remember the beating. And only by the grace of Jesus Christ do they no longer hurt me. I can see them, I can feel them, but they no longer are painful in my life. Just because I traveled my way to my place because it made sense to me. So Paul is saying, listen, you should have listened to me, folks. I told you we should have stayed in this place. You would have avoided all this damage and loss. Verse 22, but, I love it because the Bible is full of buts. God is a God of buts. Because he says, I know, Neil, you did this. I know you went there. You weren't supposed to. I know I called you over here and you went and did that. But, I love you still. And in spite of you, even though you were doing everything you possibly could to be lost, to get adrift and stranded out at sea, but I desperately want to save you. But take courage. None of you will lose your lives. Even though the ship will go down. Even though the ship will go down, none of you will lose your lives. 23, for last night, an angel of the God whom I belong, number one, I belong to him. And number two, and whom I serve. You want to be right with God? You want to be on that ship of safety? You need to belong to him, number one. And that doesn't mean just showing up to church over here, y'all. That doesn't mean just sitting in our growth groups during the week and our tithes and offerings and everything. You belong to him. You've given your heart 100% to him. You know those things you're still holding back. Folks, I know the things that I'm still struggling to give to him. I need to belong to him. When you are his, he owns you completely. There is nothing held back. Not those pet sins, not those disrespect, nothing is held back. Number one, you need to belong to him. And number two, you need to serve him. When he calls, where he calls, and how he calls. Everybody is called to serve. We were all called to be disciples. Disciples do not sit still and silent. We were all called to belong. Does he own you? Does he own all of you? Can you confidently sit here in this pew, watching online? Can you confidently say, God owns all of me? And number two, because if he owns you, you will serve him. Am I serving him with everything I've got? Or do I have excuses to not serve today or this way or that? Do I serve him? So I belong, and whom I serve stood before beside me, and he said, don't be afraid, Paul, for you will surely stand trial before Caesar. And what's more, if that wasn't enough, God in his goodness has granted safety to everyone sailing with you. Them soldiers the non-Christians, the unbelievers, all those people, just because they were in proximity to Paul, who belonged to God and served him. Because of their proximity to Paul, they were saved. Because God is looking for every possible excuse to save every possible person. What does that mean for the church today? If we are called to be Paul, if we belong to God, if we serve Him, we are on that boat. And you know what, folks? We need to bring people on that journey with us. That boat is heading to salvation in Jesus Christ. That boat is heading to heaven. But we cannot be witnesses as we sail by somebody. Look, folks, there is a place for traveling evangelists. They come to a place and they preach and they inspire and they bring in people to learn about Jesus for the first time. But if there is not somebody in that boat to receive them and go on life's journey with them, those folks will never get on that ark of safety. All of us are called to invite people in that journey of life with us. That doesn't come easy for all of us. You know, last week I shared a witness, a testimony of our Thanksgiving dinner, which was really taken over by my sister-in-law, Deepthi, because out of the love and compassion of her heart, she invited coworkers, strangers, all kinds of people to our house. It came naturally for her to invite people into her boat. It doesn't come so naturally for all of us, but just because it doesn't come naturally doesn't mean we're not called to do it. You understand? In our weakness, God will make us strong. If you belong to Him, He will give you the power to serve. We got to enjoin them in the journey with them. Invest in them. Be there in their trials, in their sorrows, in their suffering. Be with them in their joys and in their praise. Be in life's journey on that boat with them, because they will be saved because of their proximity to you. And so the question then is, if we are sitting here in these pews, if we are watching online, and if we believe we are sitting in the boat of Jesus Christ that is going to take us unto salvation in heaven, who is taking that journey with you right now? Are you on that boat alone? Because I challenge you, folks, if you realize you are in that boat alone, you may not be in that boat at all. Jesus is calling you to invite His children on that journey with Jesus. Who has He placed on your heart to call today? It might look like a sinking ship, folks. This church, Living Water, and every other church is going to get battered and tossed about. Your life is going to get battered. The storms are going to come. The devil is going to do everything he possibly can to bring you under. But this ship will not fail. This ship will not fail. I want to jump to verse 39. And when morning dawned, they didn't recognize the coastline, but they saw a bay with a beach. They could see the coastline of heaven just ahead. They saw the signs. Just faintly, they knew the end was near. Life was falling apart. The church was falling apart. But just off in the distance, the signs had started to come. There is land ahead. So when they saw a bay with a beach and wondered if they could get there to shore by running the ship aground, so they cut off the anchors and left them in the sea. In other words, they were all in at this point. When you cut the anchors off your ship, that's it. You're setting the sails and there is no going back. You are 100% committed. That's what Jesus is calling you today. No turning back. No more navigating on your own. Cut those anchors. I don't know what the anchors in your life are. Cut those anchors, set those sails, and point that thing to the land of Jesus Christ. You are all in. Your chips are on the table. Everything is out there. And so they cut off the anchors, left them in sea, and then they lowered the rudders, raised the foresail, and headed toward shore. But they hit a shoal and ran the ship aground too soon, and the bow of the ship stuck fast, while the stern was repeatedly smashed by the force of the waves and began to break apart. Because the closer you get to heaven, folks, the closer you get to fully committing your life to Jesus Christ, the devil will attack as he has never attacked before. And it will seem like your life will shatter into pieces. The soldiers even wanted to kill the prisoners to make sure they didn't swim ashore and escape. But, because the God is a God of buts. But the commanding officer wanted to spare Paul, so he didn't let them carry out their plan, and he ordered all who could swim to jump overboard first and make for land. And now listen closely, verse 44, the last moment of that ship, others held onto planks or debris from the broken ship, so everyone escaped safely to shore. Because folks, no matter the beating that your life is going to take, no matter the beating that God's church is going to take, even when the things tear apart into pieces and it looks like the devil has won over your life and over your church, God says, hold on. Hold on. Whatever little debris you can't see 5 feet in front of you, but you see that broken piece of wood, just hold on. Yes. Because God's ship is not just made out of any oak or timber, but those broken pieces of that ship are nothing but the broken pieces of the cross of Jesus Christ. And that cross will never, ever fail. God says, hold on. Hold on. And you will make it home. His home for eternity. And forever. You know, my appeal to you is simple today. In your bulletins, you will see a next step card. My next step. Maybe God is speaking on your heart. Maybe the Spirit is touching you right now. And He is saying, you need to belong to me. Maybe you've never given your life to Jesus Christ, but today the Spirit has touched you and spoken to you, and today you want to hold on to Him no matter the trials and the storms and the struggles of your life. You want to commit it to Him and trust in His unfailing promise that He will see you home. On your next step card, I just want you to put a check where it says, I want to commit my life to Jesus Christ. If you're watching us online, go to our website, livingwatersda.org, and click on the My Next Step button there and make your commitment there. Maybe God is calling you to belong to Him that much more. Maybe He's calling you to serve Him now more fully, more completely than ever before. And today, you're ready to take that next step in your journey with Jesus. I want you to put a check next to my next step is to hold on. To hold on, even when you can't see what's ahead of you, you can't see what's behind you, you seem like you are all alone out at sea, you don't know how to swim, and you see gale force winds whipping at you, and you see giant waves crashing all around you. When life seems lost, you're going to say, my next step, Jesus, is to just hold on to you. Take that next step. Make that commitment sure. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for your ship of safety. And Father, you know our weaknesses. You know our trials. You know the struggles of our life. You know, Father, when we lean on our own self and our own understanding, and you know we get fearful when we can't see or control all that goes around us. But Lord, today we say, hold on. Heavenly Father, we don't have the strength to hold on, but in the name of Jesus, strengthen our grip on you. For we trust you today that you will bring us home. Father, today seal the commitments that have made those who have given their life to you for the very first time, those who have given their life to you now, ever more some completely, Father. May we belong to you. May we serve you. May we be as Paul in that boat, bringing everyone onto this boat with us, so that just by being around us in the Jesus, the God whom we serve, all will be saved. In Jesus' most precious and holy name I pray. Amen. And amen.